To hear what it sounds like with the traffic cone mute in. Could you maybe do something with that?
Yeah, I can.
Thanks, dude.
Actually, I'm gonna that this soon. Did you steal that from the parking lot?
No, I actually got the
from the city of London.
It's like a hurdy gurdy. It's actually really cool. It was an awesome sound.
Seals the horn, and it doesn't actually allow enough air to vibrate out of the horn. So it actually messes up the end direction. And every single bugle fingering will actually be impacted completely different due to length. And actually, the end correction is varying due to the actual outcome of the horn. Yes?
So would you compare that to like stock horn?
No! This is, the funny thing is this was part of my research into my last recital on making the stop mute is I tried this, I hoped for this, and it was the worst option. By far.
I'm very interested in the double reed use that you show us. I have two questions about it.
Yes.
First, how do you feed it so it doesn't fall? And second, do you get to control the range? And if so, how do you control it? Or is it so limited that you can just make certain sounds on it?
First, so it's an oboe and a contrabassoon reed. As you can see, there's cork on the very bottom.
Oh, okay.
I built up the actual piece, so it would fit into the lead pipe. Same thing with the contrabassoon reed is if you put anything on the end and mess up the back, then it actually messes up the sound or differs the sound. And so you have to be able to build it, the actual device itself, yeah, so that it does work. Now, the second answer is the higher the reed, the less manipulation. The lower the reed, the actual more manipulation. So when you put in these actual mouthpieces, they don't differ the pitch. The actual first bugle of the instrument, the open bugle, they're all sounding an F because this is an F instrument. When you change the actual length on the lower actual pitched mouthpieces, they will actually change. These will not. The higher you go, the less difference there is. It's because the actual overtone sequence is so high that no matter what you do, it's all going to be the same variant.
Yeah.
This is low enough in the actual overtone sequence that this will actually change with the actual length. You can create squeaks and bite the reed to get an octave difference, but it's very, very hard.
Now, one last question. Do you find things written in the literature that require
yes.
use of those?
Yes. Okay. Pernick who is one of the lesser known tuba players here in the States, but back in Europe, he's one of the most known people. He's crazy. He's possibly, I think, the craziest tuba player that's ever lived. He actually created his own horn. He took a tuba and modified it completely for Piternica, which is a piece written for him by Slotnov. And it's either in Ukrainian or in German, and that's the only edition that you can find. And it calls for a flugelhorn bell, a trumpet bell, trombone bell, a trombone mouthpiece, a barry sax mouthpiece, a contrabassoon reed, just a bassoon reed, and what was it called? Hookah pipes, the actual pipes of hookah. Oh. And so what you do is you actually, as you play the piece, you have to have different lead pipes affixed to your actual lead pipe. So you have to have a barry sax modified mouthpiece that goes into your horn separate from your actual played mouthpiece. Same with both of these. And then as you play, you actually have to take out different slides and put on different bells. So you put the flugelhorn on the third valve, you put the trombone bell on the fourth valve at one point. Yes, there is literature that does call for this kind of thing. Any other questions?
I'm sorry, I have one. I saw like a wide variety of extended techniques that you showed us, especially in the last piece. Uh-huh. Is there any others that you didn't account for this recital? I mean, something else that we should know about extended techniques or people that have gone a little bit farther than that? I don't know how far you can go after that, but are there people that have tried something else? Or?
There's only one other piece that I can actually think of off the top of my head, which is the Omenahaya Brand Ferneyhound, which utilizes a long thin balloon, you know, the one that you make balloon animals. Mm-hmm. You cut off one end and you put the other, you put one on your mouthpiece and one on your lead pipe, one end, and you blow through, and it creates a god awful racket. It's crazy.
Sounds like a project, huh?
It is a project. And other than that, this document is hoping to aim to get as much the breath as far as I can. So, as the answer is no, I don't think other than that actual extended technique that I can do.
There's a general sort of category of adding stuff on.
Yes. Oh. And that's,
did you see the video that somebody put up yesterday of a slide whistle?
Yeah.
No.
Yeah, they put a slide whistle in the second end.
Yes! Finally, people are doing it! So, and that's why I said, from my account, because in my research, the only thing that I could really find was bowing a horn. And my horn is very difficult to bow because...
Now, do you mess up with pedals and electronics and all stuff that...
But that's a whole different thing.
Okay.
I think that is an extended technique all in itself. Mm. And that is a learned behavior that I think that you have to sit down and really work with. And I've only done very little of that. I've done post-prelude program by Lugino, which is a live process piece, but that was with another person actually processing the electronics. I have done pedal work with Sarah J. Hargis, who is the rock star flutist or flautist, and she does a lot of things, and I think your girlfriend knows her, where she does a lot of things with just pedaling, actually looping herself on stage, and she does some really cool stuff. Another person that I worked with is Ryan Eubanks, who is a trombone player, jazz trombone player in New York, who does a lot of that. I mean, I got to do a workshop with him just a little bit to see how that works. Yes, sir.
At what level of student development would you even start talking about extended techniques, and what exercises would you start on?
Okay, so first question answer, I think, is early as possible, in all honesty. I have a student in Maryland, a personal friend, that his son or her son actually wanted to quit band until I started showing him how to do multiphonics. And he was in eighth grade. And once he started seeing how to do multiphonics, he became more intrigued into the actual sound making of this instrument. And unfortunately, he did quit playing, but I think
like any technique, why limit it to an age? I think that any technique should be available to every student. Now, with that, should they be putting into everyday music? That's another debate, but I think that we should introduce it at a young age, like any technique. Students should have the ability to do whatever they need to. Now, the next question, the answer is no. As of right now, there are people that are looking into possibly making actual books, method books, that surround extended technique, but at this time, there is no actual printed method or